Hello friends, I'm Ravi Verma and I welcome you to my channel The SR Concepts. Thank you for watching and liking my videos. Please subscribe to the channel and press the bell icon for future notifications. In my previous video, I discussed about the overview of the structure of the cell. In this video, the topic of our discussion will be the plasma membrane. So I'm starting with the plasma membrane. So let's start learning. Look at these points. The outermost delicate elastic membranous covering of the cell that separates its contents from the external environment is called plasma membrane. Plasma membrane is called selectively permeable membrane because it allows entry and exit of certain substances through it while restricting other materials to pass through it. Next, it is made up of lipid bilayer and proteins embedded in it. Next, the small carbohydrates are attached at places on outer side of the plasma membrane. So my dear students, as you know that plasma membrane is found in every cell. It is also called cell membrane or the plasma lemma. It is a thin and delicate membranous covering, and its function is to separate the internal contents, the contents of the cell, from the external environment. It also plays an important role in regulating the exchange of material with the external environment. Means plasma membrane selects which material will move out or which will come into the cell through it. Means it regulates the exchange of materials with the external environment. So because the plasma membrane allows some materials to pass through it and also to come into it, into the cell through it. So in this way we can say that it selects what will go through it and what will not go. Actually, it does not allow some other materials to pass through it, but allows some materials to pass through it. So that's why the plasma membrane is called selectively permeable membrane. Right now, how is the structure of the plasma membrane? The plasma membrane is made up of lipid bilayer and proteins embedded in it. Some carbohydrates are also attached on the outer surface of the plasma membrane. Let's have a look at the structure of the plasma membrane in this diagram. Here you can see small light blue colored spherical structures. And with each such spherical structure, there are two black tails attached. Here you can see the two black tails are attached. So such a structure with a spherical head and two black tails, this structure is a single lipid molecule or a single lipid particle, you can say, right? So here you can see that there is one layer on the outer surface. One layer of lipid is on the outer surface. Another layer is towards the downside or towards the lower side, right? So we can say that there are two layers of lipid molecules. So that's why these two layers are called lipid bilayer. So we can say that the basic structure of the plasma membrane is made up of lipid bilayer. Now some proteins are embedded in it. Here you can see this is a long fibrous protein, right? This is a big globular protein. So you can say that plasma membrane is made up of lipid and protein. Some sugar molecules are also attached on the outer surface, but on the inner surface there is no carbohydrate molecules. My dear, this outer surface is called extra cytoplasmic surface of the cell membrane, and this is called the cytoplasmic. This downwards is called, this layer is called, or this surface is called the cytoplasmic surface of the cell membrane because it is towards the cytoplasm. Now, what is the function of the plasma membrane? First function is to separate the contents of the cell from the external environment. Second is to regulate the exchange of materials with the external environment. The exchange of materials takes place by diffusion, osmosis, endocytosis, and exocytosis. Sometimes plasma membrane also becomes modified to perform some specialized functions. For example, in intestinal cell, in the lining of intestine, the cells which are towards the inner side, in those cells plasma membrane gets modified, gets folded into finger like projections. These are called micro villi, so that the surface area of the cell increases and absorption of food takes place at a faster rate. Next, let's understand how does the exchange of materials with the external environment through plasma membrane take place. There, the substances may pass across the membrane without or with expenditure of energy. On this basis, this exchange is of two types. Actually, when any substance, any chemical, any molecule passes through the membrane into or out of the cell, then it is called transport. This is called transport of substances. So the transport of substances is of two types. One is passive transport and another is active transport. Passive means when cell has nothing to do, cell doesn't spend any energy, and the materials move into the cell or out of the cell without expenditure of energy. So when some materials move into the cell or out of the cell without expenditure of cell's energy, it is called passive transport. But in some other cases, sometimes the materials have to be thrown out of the cell or brought into the cell by expenditure of energy, means when the cell spends some energy on either bringing something in or throwing some substances out of the cell. Such a transport is called active transport. Now, the passive transport takes place by two different processes. One is diffusion and another is osmosis. So let's understand the first process. What is diffusion? Diffusion is the tendency of any substance or tendency of or the process of movement of substances like solid, liquid or gases from region of their higher concentration to region of their lower concentration, right? So every substance has a tendency that it will move from those regions where it is in high concentration to those regions where it is in lower concentration. For example, if we talk about a deodorant bottle, suppose you have a deodorant bottle, right? You know that the substance, the material of deodorant is in high concentration, is in very high amount, or we can say is in very high concentration inside the bottle, right? But outside the bottle, the concentration of the deodorant material is nil or very less, we can say. In that case, what happens when you press the nozzle and when you give some space to escape, the material starts moving from region of high concentration to region of low concentration, that is from inside the bottle to outside the bottle. So this is a case of diffusion. I hope you have understand what is diffusion, right? Now let's understand how the materials move into the cell or out of the cell by the process of diffusion. One important process takes place when exchange of respiratory gases takes place, right? Carbon dioxide and oxygen, these two gases are called respiratory gases because oxygen is used and carbon dioxide is produced during respiration. Okay, so let's understand this process. How does the exchange of carbon dioxide and oxygen with the external environment of the cell takes place? You know that every cell performs respiration. So those cells which perform respiration by the help of oxygen, you know that during respiration, food molecules like like glucose reacts with oxygen inside the cell, right? And it breaks down into carbon dioxide plus water. So glucose reacts with oxygen inside the cell and breaks down into carbon dioxide plus water. And in this chemical reaction, a large amount of energy is released. And this process of obtaining energy from food materials by its oxidation is called respiration, right? So here you can see that inside the cell, oxygen is being used and carbon dioxide is being produced during respiration. So what happens, you know that during respiration, the oxygen concentration should be less inside the cell because it is being utilized, and carbon dioxide concentration should be high because it being produced inside the cell. Now the cells which respire by the help of oxygen, they usually live in those areas where their concentration of oxygen is high. So you know that a concentration of oxygen is high outside the cell, in the medium outside the cell, and the concentration of oxygen is less inside the cell. In such a case, by the process of diffusion, oxygen moves from outside to inside the cell, and in this process the cell does not spend any energy. So this is a type of passive transport of oxygen, right? On the other hand, you know that carbon dioxide concentration is high inside the cell, but it's low outside the cell, because cells generally live in those areas where concentration of carbon dioxide is low. So as long as the carbon dioxide concentration is low outside the cell, right, what will happen? That carbon dioxide will diffuse from region of high concentration, that is inside the cell, to region of low concentration, that is outside the cell. So this we can say that oxygen and carbon dioxide are exchanged with the external environment by the process of diffusion, and in this process cell does not spend any energy. So this is a type of passive transport. Now not only oxygen, carbon dioxide are exchanged by the diffusion, but many other materials, small molecules like glucose, amino acids, or some ions like sodium and chloride ions, bicarbonate ions, these all small molecules are actually moving in and out of the cell by the process of diffusion. Okay, now let's understand the next term. You can take the screenshot and make your notes. I'm not going to read all the text which is written in this presentation. So let's understand what is osmosis. Dear students, osmosis is diffusion of water or solvent molecules across a semi-permeable membrane, and obviously it is the movement from region of high concentration to the region of low concentration. So we can define that osmosis is the diffusion of water or solvent across the semi-permeable membrane from region of higher concentration to region of lower concentration. Okay, so for this we need to understand what is solvent first. Okay, so let's understand. Dear students, there is a term solution, right? For example, when you dissolve some sugar in water, right? So when sugar is completely dissolved in water and no individual particle of sugar are seen, then such a mixture will be called solution, right? Now solution has two components. One component which is in lesser amount, that is sugar, and the other component which is in larger amount, that is water. So the component of any solution which is in less amount or small amount is called solute, So sugar is a solute in this solution. Now what about water? Water is in large amount. So such a component which is in larger amount, that component of solution is called the solvent, right? So now you understand what is the term solvent. So in a solution of sugar in water, water is a solvent and sugar is a solute. So now let's understand what is osmosis. Let us clear this concept by the help of this diagram, right? Here you can see there is a container, and the container is divided into two equal halves by a very thin membrane that is called partially permeable membrane or semi-permeable membrane. Right, why this membrane is called semi-permeable? Because it allows only solvent particles or water particles to pass through it. It will not allow the solute particles, right? So now this is the right side, this is the left side of the container. Now you can see that on the right hand side there is a dilute solution of sugar, and on the left hand side we have kept a concentrated sugar solution. Now, what is meaning of dilute sugar solution and concentrated sugar solution? Dilute sugar solution will be that solution which has relatively lesser amount of sugar dissolved in it. But concentrated sugar solution will be that which has comparatively higher or larger amount of sugar dissolved in it. For example, if you make one solution in 100 ml water, if you make two sugar solutions in 100 ml water, right? In one solution, you add 5 gram and in other solution, you add 20 gram of sugar in the same amount of solvent. Then that solution which has lesser amount of solute will be called a dilute sugar solution. And that which has larger, like 20 gram, then it is called concentrated sugar solution. So here you can see that the solvent particles, that is water particles, are shown by blue dots and the solute particles are shown by red dots on both sides. Okay, here you can see water molecules are represented by blue and sugar molecules are represented by red dot. Okay, now you can see on the right hand side there is a dilute solution. Dilute solution has larger amount of water and very little amount of sugar. On the left hand side there is a concentrated sugar solution. It has less amount of solvent, that is water molecules, and a very large amount of sugar, that is represented by red particles, right? So now you know that through this membrane only blue particles, that is the water molecules, can move. The solvent molecules can move, but the sugar molecules can not move. Now you know that water will also follow the law of diffusion, the process of diffusion. So you know that in such a case, when there is a semi-permeable membrane that allows only water molecules, then what will happen? That the water molecules will move from right hand side to the left hand side. So this is a type of diffusion of water molecules, and this is taking place through a semi-permeable membrane or partially permeable membrane. So this is called osmosis. Once again, let us remind the definition of osmosis, that osmosis is the diffusion of water molecules through a partially or semi-permeable membrane from region of high concentration to region of low concentration. So I hope that the concept of osmosis is very clear to you now. Look, what will be the result of this osmosis? That most of the water will move to the left hand side. So in this way, on the right hand side, the amount of solution will decrease, but on the left hand side, the amount of solution will increase. Now let's go back to the theory. Okay. Here let's understand what is the importance of osmosis for living cells. Look, there is a question. What will happen if we put an animal cell or plant cell into a solution of sugar or salt in water? Okay, so one of the following three things could happen, right? These three things, or these three phenomena which could take place, I will be explaining by the help of a diagram. You need to just take the screenshot of these and read them later, okay, after watching the video. So look at this diagram here. In this diagram, I am going to explain what could happen when a cell is placed in a solution of sugar or salt. Look, there are three beakers, beaker 1, 2 and 3, right? Now look at the beaker present in the middle. This is this beaker, right? You can see that in this beaker, a dilute sugar solution, right? A dilute sugar solution has been taken. And in that dilute sugar solution, red blood cell has been placed, that is also called RBC. Okay. So you know that dilute solution is that solution which has comparatively very little amount of solute particles. So obviously the concentration of water molecules will be very high. Now, what is the meaning of hypotonic solution? Hypotonic solution is that solution which has higher concentration of water. as compared to the concentration of water inside the cell, right? So if the solution has higher concentration of water as compared to the concentration of water inside the cell which is placed in it, then such a solution is called hypotonic solution, right? So in this case, when water is high concentration outside the cell and inside the cell its concentration is less, so where should be the direction of the diffusion of water? The water will diffuse from outside to inside. This will be called osmosis of water. And because the water is moving into the cell, these green arrows are showing that water is moving into the cell, because outside the cell water concentration is high. So because the water is moving into the cell, this type of osmosis of water is called endosmosis. Okay, so when water will move into the cell should swell. So that's why here a larger RBC is seen, right? Because water is moving into the cell. So once again, we should recap it, that the solution which has higher concentration of water as compared to the cell which is dipped in it is called a hypotonic solution. This is generally a very dilute solution, right? And in such a case, when the cell will be placed in a hypotonic solution, water moves into the cell by the process of endosmosis. Now look at the second beaker. In this beaker, you can see there is a concentrated solution. You know that concentrated solution has a very large concentration, or higher concentration we can say, of solute or sugar particles. So these black dots are representing the sugar particles, which is the solute of the solution, right? So obviously in this solution the concentration of water will be less. Okay, so the concentration of water is less. So if the concentration of water in any solution is lesser outside the cell but high inside the cell, right? So such a solution is called hypertonic solution. Once again, let me describe it. Concentrated solutions are generally hypertonic solutions, because in those solutions concentration of water is less as compared to the cell which is dipped in it, right? So in such a case, what should happen? Because you know that inside the cell water concentration is high as compared to the outside the cell, so the water should diffuse out of the cell. These green arrows are representing the direction of diffusion of water, right? So this is called exosmosis. This movement of water is called exosmosis, right? Okay, so when cells are placed in any hypertonic solution or concentrated solution, water moves out of the cell by the process of exosmosis. In such a case, the cell should shrink. Now let's look at another beaker. In this beaker you will see there is a normal solution which is neither very high nor very dilute, right? And suppose this solution has an equal concentration of water, means the water concentration in the solution is equal to the water concentration inside the cytoplasm of the cell. Such a solution will be called isotonic solution. In that case, water will move into the cell and out of the cell at same rate, means the number of particles moving into the cell is equal to the number of particles moving out of the cell. So there will be no net movement of water, right? And the cell will remain normal in size. So hope you understand these three terms: isotonic, hypotonic and hypertonic, and what is exosmosis and endosmosis. Okay, so now you can take screenshots from there and make your notes. Take the screenshot, you can make your notes. You can also read the same things in NCERT textbook, right? Make your notes. Okay, you can read the text and understand it very clearly. Now, what are the benefits of osmosis to the cell? Why the osmosis is important to the cells? Look, a unicellular freshwater organisms like amoeba or paramecium or bacteria, right? These all and most of the plant cells, they tend to gain water through osmosis, right? You know that these freshwater organisms and some most of the plants which are living in water, they take water by the process of osmosis. Okay, another important point is absorption of water by plant roots is also in an example of osmosis. So you have been reading, you have been studying for many years that roots of the plants absorb water and minerals. So the water is absorbed by the process of osmosis. Now we have studied that if there is a cell, right, you know that small particles like glucose, amino acids, some ions like sodium ion, chloride ion, and respiratory gases like carbon dioxide, oxygen, these all small molecules can move into the cell or out of the cell by the process of diffusion. Or we have also studied that water moves in and out of the cell by the process of osmosis, because these are small particles, these are small molecules, so they can easily pass through the plasma membrane. But what about if some big particle like some bacteria has to be brought into the cell, some big particles have to be brought into the cell? In that case endocytosis takes place. So let's understand what is endocytosis, right? You know that plasma membrane is flexible. First read the text. The flexibility of cell membrane also enables the cell to engulf food and other materials from its external environment. Such process is known as endocytosis. Amoeba acquires its food through such process. So let me describe you what is endocytosis. Look, suppose this is an amoeba, right? You know that the shape of the amoeba is not fixed shape, and its cell always keep making cytoplasmic extensions. These cytoplasmic extensions are called pseudopodia. Means false feet, right? So these pseudopodia are used for movement in amoeba, and also it helps in capturing the food or engulfing the food inside the cell. So this process of engulfing the food or process of engulfing big particles into the cell is called endocytosis. How does it take place? Suppose this is the bacterium and this bacteria need to be engulfed. What will happen? That the amoeba will make pseudopodia, and these pseudopodia will cover up the bacterium. At the terminal end, the two membranes will fuse, okay, will fuse, and finally this condition will come that the bacterium will be taken into the cell inside a pouch of plasma membrane, and these plasma membrane will fuse again, right? So in this way we can say that bacteria has been engulfed as it is inside the cell, inside a pouch of plasma membrane. This pouch, this vesicle of plasma membrane in which the food has been engulfed, is called food vacuole. Food vacuole. Right. So such a process is called endocytosis. The same kind of process also takes place in our immune system cells. Macrophages and neutrophils are important cells which are like amoeba. They also keep making pseudopodia, and when they want to engulf some bacteria or virus, they do the same type of process as has been described in amoeba. Such a process in that case is called phagocytosis. S-I-S, phagocytosis, right? Okay, dear students, so we have understand how the materials move into and out of the cell. Sometimes you know that in active transport, the materials are thrown out of the cell or into the cell. Even when there is not a good gradient of concentration, means suppose if the concentration of some materials inside the cell is very high, like glucose. You know that glucose concentration suppose is high inside the cell, and outside the cell glucose concentration is less, but even in that case the glucose is taken into the cell, which is against the process of diffusion, right? So such bringing of glucose into the cell will need to spend some energy by the cell, right? So such a movement, such a transport is called active transport. Okay, now let's understand about the new structure, another structure, that is cell wall. So cell wall is found in bacterial cell, plant cell and fungal cell. In animal cells, cell wall is not found, right? So bacterial cell, plant cell and fungal cell have another rigid covering outside the plasma membrane, that is called cell wall, right? So suppose this is a plant cell, right? And this red line is representing the plasma membrane. So where is the position of cell wall? Cell wall lies outside the plasma membrane, right? And suppose this is representing the plasma membrane, and this structure is representing the cell wall, right? Plasma membrane and cell wall are attached to each other. Okay, now the cell walls are made up of some complex carbohydrate materials. For example, in plant cells, the chief component of the cell wall is cellulose, which is a polymer of glucose, right? In fungi, the chief component of the cell wall is chitin, and in bacteria, the chief component of the cell wall is peptidoglycan. Peptidoglycan is also called murine. Murine, right? Or muriatic acid also it is called. So dear students, because the materials of the cell wall are complex carbohydrates, they are very strong and rigid, so they provide structural strength to the plant, to the cells in which the cell walls are present. So what are the functions of cell wall? Functions of cell wall is that cell wall maintains the shape of the cell because cell wall is rigid. Second function is cell wall permits the cells of plants, fungi, bacteria to withstand very dilute or hypotonic external media without bursting. Now let's understand this point, right? Suppose there is a hypotonic solution in a beaker. Hypotonic solution, I am using term hypotonic solution. So hypotonic solution, you know that has a higher concentration of water. And suppose if a cell has been placed in it, right? This is the cell wall. Okay, so in such a case, you know that water will move from outside to inside the cell in all directions. When water will move into the cell, a pressure will develop on the cell wall, and because of this pressure, the cell should burst, but it does not actually burst because the cell wall is very strong. Cell wall is strong, so this strength of cell wall protects the cells from bursting when the cells are placed in a hypotonic solution, right? So these all types of cells, plant cells, fungal cells and bacterial cells, they can live even in those waters or even in those medium, in those media in which water concentration is high or they are hypotonic. Another important point is because of their walls, such cells can withstand much greater changes in the surrounding medium than animal cells. Animal cells do not have cell wall. So when An animal cell is placed in some hypotonic or hypertonic solution. They usually destroy. They either burst or they shrink and they just die, right? But the cell wall in plant, fungal and bacterial cell protects them from bursting. Now let's understand the term plasmolysis. Now think about an opposite phenomena. Suppose a plant cell has been placed in a hypertonic solution. In a hypertonic solution, I am using term hyper. Hypertonic solution means that solution which is very, very concentrated, and in that the water concentration is very less. So concentration of water is less outside the cell. Now inside the cell, concentration of water is high. So what will happen? That water will move from inside to outside the cell. In such a case, what will be the effect on cell wall? The cell wall will remain intact. It will maintain its original shape. But what will happen? That the plasma membrane of the cell along with the cytoplasm will shrink and get detached from the cell wall. Such a cell in which the plasma membrane along with the cytoplasm has been shrunken and has been detached from the cell wall, right, when it is placed in a hypertonic solution, right, such a cell is called plasmolysed cell. Plasmolysed cell. And this process is called plasmolysis. This process is called plasmolysis. So once again, I must recap it that when a plant cell or bacterial cell or fungal cell is placed in a hypertonic solution, that solution which has a lesser concentration of water as compared to the cytoplasm of the cell, the water moves out of the cell by the process of exosmosis. In that case, cytoplasm along with the cell membrane gets detached from the cell wall, and such a cell is called plasmolysed cell, and such a process is called plasmolysis. Now if you want to reverse the situation, suppose if the cell is taken out from the hypertonic solution, it is placed in a hypotonic solution, then the water will move into the cell and the cell will again achieve its original position, right? Such a process will be called deplasmolysis. That will be called deplasmolysis when the cell is placed from hypertonic to hypotonic solution. Deplasmolysis. Okay. So this is all about the cell wall. Our next topic will be nucleus, which will be covered in the next video. Thank you for watching this video. Please like the video and subscribe to the channel. Please do your studies regularly and sincerely. Take care. Thank you.